It'll come up again a few times. We make a few stops near it because Wilhelmstrasse was the main government street that extends from right down next to the Brandenburg Gate, all the way down into Kreuzberg. Here, starting right up the top, you had Hitler's headquarters, the new Reich Chancellery, as it was called, and then right next to it, you had this massive building. Here, this was built in 1935 they often put Reich, which is like a kingdom or a realm, in front of what the title. So this was like the Imperial Aviation Ministry, the Reich's Aviation Ministry. Here, so everything to do with aircraft, including the Air Force, the Luftwaffe, were managed from this building. So this was the headquarters of Hermann Göring, the most powerful Nazi after Hitler himself. A little bit further down, then across the street, you would have had the Propaganda Ministry that would have been run by Joseph Goebbels. Goebbels is funny because he himself was a socialist and wasn't particularly anti-Semitic. I mean, he had a doctrine in philosophy, and his professor had actually been a Jew. But he just thought Hitler was amazing. He was fanatically loyal to Hitler, thought Hitler was absolutely amazing. Goebbels headed Propaganda Ministry, but before the Nazis came to power, he was actually sent here to Berlin to oversee the Nazi Party. He arrived here in November of 1927 into Anhalter-Bahnhof, which is our next stop, just down over here. At the time, the Nazis only had a couple of hundred members here in Berlin, but he whipped them into shape. He made them the big party of protest. At the time, the brown shirts, the Nazis, you know, thugs and tough guys, and that they were being sent out to start fights with the communists. At the time, the communists were seen as the major party of protest for, you know, the poor, the dispossessed, the unemployed, the low skilled, and poorly educated. Goebbels here in charge of the Nazi Party in Berlin wanted to provoke them into street fights. So what would happen, it almost felt like a civil war in Germany at times at this point in the late 1920s, early 1930s. You could have a Nazi communist party gathering, we'll say, in a beer hall or something like that somewhere in Berlin. And one of the communist party members would be making a speech, and then out of nowhere, a couple of guys would stand up in the crowd, shout anti-communist slogans. They'd like rip off their jackets or something. They'd have like, swastika armbands and brown shirts, and identifying them as members of the Nazi party. And a riot would ensue. Same thing, the Nazis could be out in a parade or a protest, whatever, through some neighborhood, and then out of the side streets, communists would attack them. So there was these running street fights, and that was, you know, an actual active policy of Joseph Goebbels, was to create this sense of instability so that then the Nazis could offer stability to people. And it's a big boost of support here in Berlin, but they struggled for a very long time to gain any real major support here in Berlin. It was only with the Wall Street crash where even, you know, skilled organized labor, because usually people who are member of trade unions and skilled and organized labor didn't vote for the Nazi Party. They vote for the Social Democrats or the Communists if they were more radical. But with the Wall Street crash, and these people started losing their jobs, they started turning away from the left-wing parties and they started turning to the right-wing parties. One of the reasons for that as well, and one of the reasons the Nazis struggled, even though there was, you know, massive economic instability in the early 1920s, one reason they struggled to gain power at that point was their ideology that they were selling, which a big part of was blaming other people for Germany's problems, didn't catch on. Then people knew in the early 1920s that the Germans themselves had fought a disastrous war in the First World War, and of course that had meant massive amount of debt and war reparations afterwards. So when the Nazis were saying, oh, it's the Jews' fault and all that, nobody really believed them. There was this direct connection between Germany's suffering and their loss of the First World War. But with the Wall Street crash, the suffering created by that in Germany is a bit more abstract. It seemed like things were going good for a few years. From 1925 onwards, there's a few really good stable years in Germany, the Golden 20s or the Roaring 20s as they call it. And with the Wall Street crash, this ideology the Nazis have been selling all along, that, oh, it's somebody else's fault, so particularly the Jews, although they identified, three types of Jews. The Jews who ran Hollywood in America, the Jews who ran the international banking system, according to them, of course, ran the international banking system. And Hitler also believed that communism in Russia and the Soviet Union was also some sort of Jewish conspiracy, and they're all out to destroy Germany and the Aryan race and that sort of thing. So this next time at the Wall Street crash, there's this disconnect. People feel like things were going good. What happened all of a sudden? Of course, it was a banking crash. So again, like financial crisis in 2008, 2009, and it's very abstract. It doesn't feel real. It doesn't seem like a logical progression to people. It seems all of a sudden. So people started to think, okay, you know, maybe it is somebody else's fault. And so these Nazi, you know, conspiracies, to be honest about it, start to gain traction amongst a lot of groups in Germany. But with their rise to power, the Nazis never had a functioning government as we think of it today. Very rarely did Goebbels, Göring, and Himmler, who would have been based here, sit down together with Hitler in like a cabinet setting, like around the big table, like a government cabinet would do today. And that if you wanted to get things done, you had to get favor with Hitler, you had to be present. and appeal to Hitler directly himself, and Hitler had to take an interest in what you wanted to do, and that. So you needed to have Hitler's clear backing to get stuff done, and to cut through all the red tape and the structures of the Nazi party and get people to follow your orders. And so the final big government ministry would have been here. Now, there was never a purpose-built ministry here. This was originally a luxury hotel called the Prince Albert Hotel, but it was taken over by the Nazis, and the Reich's Central Security Ministry moved in there. So it actually became the headquarters of the Gestapo and the SS were in here, all overseen by Heinrich Himmler. They're pretty true interesting characters because they kind of reflect the support base of the Nazi party. There were some people like Goebbels who just thought Hitler was amazing, that he was such a great public speaker and stuff like that, that they were fanatically loyal to Hitler. Goring here was kind of older nobility, he was upper class. He had been an East pilot during the First World War. He'd actually been part of von Rickensdorf, the Red Baron squadron in the First World War, so he was a national celebrity. And when he joined the Nazi party, it was a big coup for them, because it was like today when a celebrity, you know, backs a political party in a campaign, and that it gets a lot of attention. It gave the party a sense of legitimacy. Before this point, they were just taught as, you know, rural, uneducated, local thugs, that sort of thing, the Nazis. When they got Goring, it made them a little bit more respectable. And more importantly, it gave them access to wealthier circles as well. So now Hitler got an invite to dinner amongst the upper class and wealthier people, and they found wealthy backers, the money that the Nazi party desperately needed for their election campaigns. And Himmler here, the head of the SS and Gestapo, he was more stereotypical of the sort of people who supported the Nazi. He was originally a farmer. He'd fought in the First World War. After the First World War with the Versailles Treaty, Germany's army, of course, was shrunk down to some about 100,000 soldiers. So he was discharged from the army, went back to his original job as a farmer, and that even worked in like a fertilizer factory for a while. But generally, you know, quite poorly educated, lowly educated, and very typical of the typical Nazi party supporter early on in the 1920s. And that he would have been early on quite anti-Semitic anyway. Anti-Semitism, I mean, is as old as Christianity. It's hundreds of years old. Jews in Germany, though, like for many countries, they were, abolished for periods of times in England and Spain and that. But in Germany, they benefited from the fractured nature of Germany for a long time. So for a while, they were banished from Berlin and Brandenburg quite early on in the Middle Ages. But they could very easily cross the border into the next little kingdom down the road, like into Saxony or into Hanover or something like that, and be very welcomed there as well. But anti-Semitism in Europe at the time was very typical between small farming communities, and that because Jewish people who weren't part of the Jewish Enlightenment, who didn't integrate, were very isolated. They kept to themselves, they intermarried and that, and they'd live in their own little villages and that. So you'd have little Jewish farming communities dotted throughout Europe and that. So people like Heinrich Himmler himself, farming community, they'd have their own little insular little village. And in down the road, you'd have a Jewish village. And of course, straight away, you get this other, they're distanced, they're away from them. So it's very easy to demonize them, see them as the other. Something goes wrong, you know, somebody's kidnapped, somebody's murdered, somebody's raped, something. It's very easy then to blame the Jews down the road. You know, they're up to no good, they can't be trusted because they stick to themselves and stuff like that. Hitler kind of updated that old kind of anti-Semitism of just being distrustful of somebody because they're a different religion and you don't know them, and that to add in this old conspiratorial elements, like the Elders of Zion, the book that really, you know, all Jews are connected and it's this global conspiracy to take over the world, and that, you know, Hitler brought that ideology and updated this older, simpler kind of rural anti-Semitism with his crazy, you know, global Jewish conspiracy to take over the world and that. So that's how Himmler ended up fanatically loyal. Also, got another guy who just thought Hitler was amazing, like that he was such a great public speaker, his worldview and all that, that he was fanatically loyal to Hitler. Nothing left of that ministry today except for a few basement walls here at the front of the administrative building and down here at the cell block. Sachsenhausen are the two oldest, Dachau just outside of Munich. Sachsenhausen, initially it was Oranienburg. The town next to Sachsenhausen is the town of Oranienburg, and that had a small camp next to it. But in 1934, that moved outside of the town to what became Sachsenhausen. Sachsenhausen had a very small Jewish community. They were usually in the minority, although after particular events like the Night of Broken Glass and the invasion of Poland, there'd be sudden increases, but then they'd be kind of redistributed to other camps, and that's so they dropped down again to a very small number within the camp. But it was mostly a camp for political opponents of the Nazi regime. So communists ended up there, asocial elements, as they called them, so homosexuals, gypsies, people with disabilities, you know, vagabonds, the work shy, they all ended up at Sachsenhaus as well. And high profile prisoners, there was all sorts of people there, like Stalin's son, Martin Niemöller, who was a part of the confessional church, who were critical of the Nazis. Herschel Greizpen was held there as well, the guy who shot the German diplomat and was used as a justification for the Night of Broken Glass. The last Republican Prime Minister of Spain was held there. They say Stalin's son already. Quite a long list of high-profile people held there. But high-profile people like that would often be transferred between Sachsenhausen. There's an actual special cell block for them there. And here, the Topography of Terror for interrogation, stuff like that, if they were considered important enough. There's a slight irony here as well. You've got the Berlin Wall here as well. We're technically on the west side of the Berlin Wall. But here, actually, Erich Honecker, who became dictator of East Germany in 1974 after the first dictator, Walter Ulbricht, resigned. He was actually held here in prison by the Nazis. You know, he was a communist, of course, at the time, so he was targeted by the Nazis. And he was in the overseer who oversaw the construction of the Berlin Wall decades later, like right here on top of the site where he'd actually been held prisoner by the Nazis as well. Today, the Topography of Terror, all free to go into. The outside part is a temporary exhibition. It's currently about Berlin during the interwar period. And inside is the permanent exhibition about the SS and Gestapo, how they operated. They ran the concentration camp systems. They administered the occupied territories and that. So a lot of information about that there. And just quickly as well, this building here next to us, as you can see, a lot of bullet and shrapnel damage on the structure here. This is the Martin Gropius building. It was built originally as part of the School of Art and Design. Today it's a dedicated exhibition center. If you recognize the name Gropius, it's because he's the granduncle of Walter Gropius, the famous Bauhaus architect. But this building was almost completely destroyed. Only some of the like ground floor walls where the bullet and shrapnel damage are actually original. And this was planned to be torn down and completely removed up until the late 1980s. It was only by the intervention of the architect Walter Gropius that the building was actually saved, and today it's a dedicated exhibition space. Here as well, it's quite a beautiful structure with its neo-Renaissance style. But guys, go ahead, take a few minutes, we'll just say about 5 minutes, we don't have that long, give a quick walk through, we'll take a few pictures as well. There's also toilets inside if anyone needs.